opposed him, and the evidence is behind this understanding.
Well, it's not that religious, but we have the situation I said in Afghanistan and Khorasan, and the fact that the Middle East is quite capable of producing black banners with forceful armies, if we include Uzbekistan and Tajikistan and so on, that and to be included sooner or later. You don't think that's what they're doing with this guy in Uzbekistan? He's all the communists. Karamov or something like that. This guy is not going to stay forever. He will be finished sooner or later. If Allah finishes him by normal death, a likelihood we will finish him by the period of whatever it is. So these are just the diseases of the history who will pass. And Islam will be dominant in that area. Sooner will stay. And the technical and the agricultural capability and enormous potential. That's number one. And number two, that's the real oppressive regimes, the tyrannical regimes are so widespread and so deep-rooted that everyone is fed up and becoming completely upset about the miserable situation. And thirdly, which is not an evidence, but there have been a flood of visions and dreams. Now, visions and dreams, you know what they are. They're quite dangerous to rely on, because we have three types of dreams. The clinic extreme, the healthy extreme, the focus, only the one from the angel, the one from Allah is true. I mean, normally it's not everyone able to distinguish, and sometimes the one from the soul, from the self, wishful thinking, materialized as a dream, especially if it mixes with circumnarration, things like that. But there have been quite many people and many scholars who have seen visions that it's very real, or they've been bayat, or the matter of the man being given bayat, and things like that. That could be indicated of something, that things are becoming close. So these three things I say, visions are not really evidence, but an indicative, especially because of the hadith said, when the day of judgment is near, then the vision of a mu'min barely fades, becomes more accurate and more exacting. So all these three things give the people strong impression that things are very close. And they look close, like an enemy dog, but sometimes you think things are very close and they still have decades to go, and sometimes things still are very far away and they come much sudden than you think. But even many hadith also did not know the time frames for many of those. It's very clear that, for example, Abu Huraira was thinking he wouldn't be able to meet Isa and was hoping that he would bring the greeting to him. None of his deathbed said, I'm not catching Isa, but anyone of you who will catch him will bring him my greeting also. Now, how many generations have passed since Abu Huraira has passed away? 40 generations, 50 generations? Yeah, something like that, and still it has not come. So sometimes people misinterpret the yushik, that the word yushik is almost happening, barely time remaining as well. All of that is. So for example, the hadith said when he stood in the pulpit and gave a khutbah for noon until Asr, came down, prayed Asr up, until the sun almost set. And they said the remaining from dunya compared to that what has passed is like that was remaining to the day. Now, some people say it is because they follow the Jewish counting of 6,000 years, which you know is nonsense. So they estimated something like 500 years, 1,000 years, 1,500. But maybe it's from the beginning of the dunya. So we're talking about 13 billion years. Then maybe a half billion, maybe 100 million. Nobody knows. So this is all guesswork. It should not only show that. Sometimes there are certain phenomena and indication which indicates that clearly. But the prophetic expression is always the day of judgment will not pass, the day of judgment will not come until this happens without giving any time frame. Only after Dajjal and Isa, the hadith are very clear that the sa'ah is very close. It's like a woman which is pregnant is about to give birth. It is, they are like a, what they call it, a bead, like a necklace which has been broken and the beads are falling one after another. That's only when the last 10 big signs come together. And the first of them is the coming of Dajjal. And Isa immediately exterminating him, Dari Ajim, I told, and then it will evolve very quickly. But that very quickly could be, as a hadith say, the people will be planting and will be harvesting and will be building cities and so on. And then we have the hadith after, we know that Isa will be performing Hajj. And there's the narration that he will be buried next to the Prophet in the chambers, fine. And the Hajj of Umar will be after him. But then the Syrian, the Habasha will come and destroy the Habasha, and it will be not, the message will be not rebuilt until Yom Qiyamah. So that's after Isa. So there's still wars, I said conflicts, but of minor type, most likely internal. warfare in the Muslim camp, and factional fights and so on. Yeah, so you see, all of these things are there's no way to give any timing. Anyone giving timing is going into a neck-breaking business.
What are the authentic signs of the army for the Quran?
There's nothing except that they come with black banners. And the only thing which will appear is obviously when because if the hadith about the black banners coming from Khorasan and asking for their rights and not be given and then they succeed in warfare, then obviously the massacre in the Arabs would be very clear. I said most likely the Gulf Arabs would be the victim for that because they would have been quite far away from what Islam they face to them, and the only way is just to put them aside by force, by assault. That's one aspect. Another aspect is that around that or before that, a man has been in bay'ah near the Kaaba. But maybe the strongest side, if we relate it to the issue of the Mahdi, because the relation is one in one hadith, which is good but not overwhelmingly strong, so that we'll fight for it, is that the army coming from Syria, possibly a guy called the Sufyani, a very mysterious figure, which I did not comment to, because the only good hadith there is only one, and there's a question mark about it. All others are just horrifying stories about the Sufyani, who send an army, or himself leading an army, and they will be swallowed by the air. So that's what we would show the people, that this one who was under attack, to be attacked, is the Mahdi. And then the one coming from Khorasan will come to inside support. So the moment you see the swallowing of the air, for an army approaching toward the Kaaba, you know it is. This is almost the opener, a clear opener. But this is just by putting the pictures together in some kind of ijtihad. It's not saying clearly when an army is swallowed, because the swallowing of the armies were established beyond doubt. It's been narrated by Hafsa radiallahu anha, by Salama, by Aisha, by Abu Huraira, in various narrations which leave no doubt that it's authentic and reliable, that there will be people attacking toward Mecca, and the people will not cease attacking and violating the sanctity of the Haram until an army will be swallowed before the Yawm al-Qiyamah. All of them will be swallowed, without exception. By a huge swallowing in the Baida. The Baida is that area between Makkah and Medina. After the Khalifa, so there's an open area before the mountains start rising up. This is the Baida, that army will be swallowed from the earth there. So that will be a clear sign. Today's time, obviously, for the Prophet of Muhammad, definitely. But is it for the Mahdi? Only if we say that the one under attack, which was given bay'ah in near al-Ka'ba, is the Mahdi. Which there are good indications and good narrations about that. So putting these stories together in one narrative is quite complex and needs to be extremely cautious. But you will know it only if you see it, when it's not really advanced. That's interesting things about such future events. And sometimes people don't recognize, for example, how many prophecies about Isa in the Old Testament. But they are small bits and scattered and partly metaphorical. And when he came, the Jews did not recognize him because they have made their own mind that he'd be a warring leader, a warrior. But that's not what the Messiah of Bani Israel is. As if Bani Israel is a da'i, not a warrior. So when he did not come according to preconceived concept, they rejected him. And so the danger is also there that some Muslims do the same by making their own image of events of their camp, by making it up or relying on fabricated evidences or weak evidences, and then they get stuck with that. Like in the case of the Dajjal, many will be stuck in his fitna. Because which we do isti'adha in salah, according to the hadith of Bukhari and Muslim, for example. So it's dangerous there. It's good to be watchful and be mindful of the fundamentals of Islam, the clear, well-established fundamentals of Islam. Then you will never go astray.
How long is Isa going to stay on this earth? The second part of this question, for the question if they're still here, some people say that this is the last century and it could be millennium.
The timing is, as I said, almost impossible, but we could safely assume if this hadith of Mahdi that they seem to be authentic and good, and would be ruling that there would be transgression and attack against Makkah and so on, with the Sufiani, that Samatar, and this man would be extremely vicious and bloodshed, the Sufiani, according to many horror stories. But only one hadith could stand such scrutiny. Even he would be slitting pregnant women bellies and taking babies out, so it would be an extremely oppressive tyrant. He will need obviously to do this several months and years. Then we have a Mahdi, if you're taking bay'ah, and the one coming from Khorasan, they need months, maybe years, to establish things and spread his rule all over the place. Then we have 7 to 9 years, so it's something like 10 years, and the Qahtali, the narration of Qahtali, that will be only 20 years, that's not very strong, but 30 years. Then we have the gap until the Malham al-Kubra, possibly with the Khalifa move to whom the rulers will come in chains. Then the Malham al-Kubra and so on, and the reconquest of Constantinople, that's again several, maybe a decade or two. The final conquest, the Ghazwat al-Hind, which Abu Hurairah wished that he would be present in that one. The one who will do Ghazwat al-Hind, and there's another evidence that al-Mahdi is separated from, because Ghazwat al-Hind could be conceivably only done if the Muslims are so strong that they will dare invade India and having a Ghazwa, a massive Ghazwa, which Abu Hurairah wished that anyone participating in the Ghazwa would be forgiven his sins. That those who participate in the Ghazwa or their children will be facing also the Dajjal. So we have a good gap. So at least we have 50, 60, 70 years. Then the best narrations about Isa, that he will be ruling 40 years and he will marry and have children. And he will die and the Muslim will pray for him, janaza. And there's some suggestion. I think it's a good suggestion that he will be buried in the chamber next to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, which makes good sense for this space for one more grave there. So then after that we have the Da'atul Ard and so on and so on. So it's not, this century is not bad. Started telling you that literally. It's difficult. Next century, maybe, if things accelerate in an enormous way. But not this century. I don't think it's enough time to accommodate for all these things. Allah, they may come very high-speed successions toward the end of the century. Most likely the present here will not be present at that time, but maybe their children, but not much clear. So about the 2012 and the end of the world, it's utter nonsense. Definitely, because I had a clear hadith that there would be 10 major ayahs, starting with the Dajjal, which we'll mention inshallah the next session, is clearly refuting that. But not knowing that, or being in a state of fear like a man, there was a wind which was made that obviously got so much sand in the air that the air became red, and the man was coming to the Masjid of Kufa, where Ibn Mas'ud was there, and said, As-sa'a qamat, as-sa'a qamat, the day of judgment has come. And Mas'ud was angry and said, the day of judgment will not come, not even in your life, nor in the life of your children, grandchildren. There will be no day of judgment until the Malham al-Kubra will happen. And there will be no, even if you have the biggest booty, you will be unhappy, because in the Malham al-Kubra, in the great battle, from the one small family, one medium family of 100 men, all of them dead except one. So how can you be happy for a swash of war if you see all your cousins, brothers, uncles all dead in the battle? So even if you have the biggest booty, nobody will be happy to even divide the booty because of the number of losses there in such a battle. After that, then maybe the next thing will come, but not now. So don't worry about this heaven being red of red sand. It's just a sandstorm, not even what you have. So there will be people who sensitive people who think any military, this is the end of the world. It's not. It's way far away down the road still.
Can we approach metaphorically to the meaning of the one eye of the Dajjal?
Only if the Dajjal is interpreted as metaphorical, but there's no good reason for that, because all the evidences describe him as a man. We know Isa is a man, it's a human being, a flesh and blood. And Rasul, when he saw a vision, he saw Isa as a man supporting himself with two angels. And he described him as a medium height with hair, which is the most beautiful hair you could imagine, nicely combed, with a bit of wave in it. And beard and appearance prophet, he's a good looking man. He did not say he's as beautiful as you.